Hello and welcome to the Tar Heel Teachers Book Club. I'm Marlo Artis. The Tar Heel Teachers Book Club is our monthly opportunity to discuss fantastic books. Each month, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of North Carolina educators who love dissecting great texts. We'll start our introductions with our friend from Carteret County.
Hey everybody, I'm Emily Golightly, and I'm the media coordinator at Newport Elementary School, and I'm also currently serving as the president-elect of the North Carolina Reading Association. You can find me on social media at EmilyGolightly3.
I'm Pamela Sands. I'm a former media coordinator and a current digital learning facilitator in Cumberland County Schools. I'm a two-time winner of both the Cumberland County Schools Media Coordinator of the Year, the North Carolina School Library Media Association's Media Coordinator of the Year. And you can find me on Twitter at LivingPamTastic.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Arisha Smalls, and I'm the AIG Program Coordinator for Cumberland County Schools. And you can follow me on Twitter at SmallsArisha.
Hello, my name is Amy Tart, and I teach fifth grade ELA and social studies at Clinton City Schools, and you can follow me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Great. Our June 2022 Tar Heel Teachers Book Club selection is Take Back the Block by Chrystal D. Giles. Be sure to share your thoughts on Twitter by using our hashtag THT Book Club. Take Back the Block explores community gentrification, justice, and friendship. Everything changes for sixth grader Wes and his community when a real estate developer offers to buy Kensington Oaks, the neighborhood Wes has lived in his entire life. Where would we like to start with Take Back the Block?
One of the things I really loved about the story was that the things that Wes did and the steps that he took were not unrealistic. Like, he did the work. He went and he researched and he made connections and found people who could help and support and like went through the right channels. He didn't like do things where you're like, yeah, but normal middle schoolers wouldn't do that. You know, he really did things and effected a great change in ways that regular kids can do. Mm-hmm. So I really liked that.
Yeah, it certainly was realistic fiction where these are things that could happen and the characters and situations were very relatable.
I agree with that. I think just his everyday decisions, some of the things that were happening with within the relationships he had with his friends were like, they were believable. Like, I bought into all of them because the way his friends, they would argue or some of the little jokes they would pass, you know, it all seemed real. And I wonder like where that came from, like who she tapped into, or does she know a group of kids? Did she observe somebody? And, you know, kind of did that play a part in her storytelling?
And I would agree with you guys. I really loved the authentic conversations, those little family and friendship moments that were just interspersed throughout. I loved seeing his nuclear family of a strong mom and dad role model that were very positive and encouraging and socially conscious. But they also shared about families that, you know, had a divorced family or, you know, multicultural families and different things that they tied in that. And it was okay to be any of those. Every single one was accepted and they were all valued in their community. And so just the way that it was so seamlessly added in that way, you know, just 10 years ago, I don't think you would have seen characters like that, so many different types in a middle grades book like this. So I just really love that representation.
I agree. It was a super easy read for me. It hooked me right from the beginning. I loved like the opening kind of scene where he's out there with his mom and he's worried about getting his Tar Heel jersey and his new shoes dirty. And right away, I was like, I like this kid. But he had the best sense of humor. And that whole family dynamic was so strong, like you said, so powerful. But I loved his sense of humor. He had great wit and the figurative language that he used, things like that, that really, I loved it. I really did like it. This is one of my favorites, I think, that we've done in a while.
Well, and being that I came from middle school, teaching middle school, when you said, like, I love this kid, right away, I was like, I know this kid. You know, I know these kids who they're about their jersey and their shoes and his just very charismatic personality. And I love the author's writing style. It was, like you said, it was a really easy to read. It just kind of flowed naturally.
I like that he wasn't perfect, because the book opening with him holding this sign and, you know, he's at this protest or whatever, like, he didn't want to be there. Like, he understood the work that needed to be done. He understood, you know, his parents doing that, but he didn't always feel like he had to be present. And just like any kid whose parents are making them do something they don't want to, like, he voiced that. He tried to get his dad on his side. I just thought, like, yes, this is very typical of this age group. And I think younger readers could relate to that.
Mm-hmm. And I really liked the evolution that he made. So the beginning of the book, he, of course, was a little bit resistant, didn't want to be, you know, out front at the protest, had to go out of obligation. But at the end, he was the one who was organizing and really had kind of made that full circle. And it was really authentic. And you could see that transition happen naturally as opposed to such a quick switch. So I really did like that. And it really felt good because that's how we all should be. We should always be evolving and growing as people and seeing how we can make positive contributions to our communities.
Go ahead.
I just want to say before we leave that, just thinking about the transition you're talking about from the beginning of the book to the end of the book, I'm glad that, you know, sometimes you read stories and the main character or characters in a book don't want to make it, like they don't want to put any effort forth or make any change until something personally happens to them. I like that his family was already interested in the work and he was already taking part, even though he didn't always want to be there. He wasn't waiting for it to get personal for him before he did something. You know what I mean? He was already kind of doing it, and then it got personal, and then, you know, he went a little harder.
Kari.
I was gonna say, but he did wait for it to get personal. Go ahead, Amy, you say it.
But I mean, in some stories, they don't take part in anything. Like, they're not doing anything for anybody else ever. And now all of a sudden, something personal has happened to them. Now they care so much. I feel like he cared. His parents did. And he was doing what he was supposed to do with his parents. But it wasn't like it was out of his scope, out of his view this whole time. Now it's personal. Now I'm going to do something.
Kari got to me. Kari pulled at my heartstrings the whole time. And I do think that, like, that was a big character development for Wes. Because, like you said, like, you know, he was at the protest, things like that. And he's like, oh, yeah, I feel bad for Kari, you know. And then slowly he started seeing more reality of, like, the depth of the situation with Kari, where his living situation, things like that. And the friend group not really being so, like, supportive of Kari. But then when Wes was kind of put into Kari's shoes, that's when it did become more personal and kind of helped develop this character in the sense of he's like, man, you know, I wasn't always looking out for Kari like I should have. And then there was Kari, you know, right with him, helping him with Kennington Oates. But Kari really got to me. I want Kari to have his own book.
I would love that too, Amy. I was thinking about the same thing. You could really just explore his journey. He was my favorite character in the book. And I really had a very difficult time trying to understand Maya's dilemma with Kari. I was expecting to be a little bit deeper or something, where he had really done something to upset her in a way, because he ended up being, you know, isolated and iced out of the group because of Maya and her demands and her personality. But to me, it wasn't anything that warranted her being that upset. And that just made her, to me, so unlikable.
But I think we all know somebody like that who's had an overreaction, and that has changed the whole dynamic. And it really isn't a justified reason.
And I think that just shows you how deep those gentrification and social issues really go, because she moved into a neighborhood where there was money and opportunities and things like that. And they kind of tagged along with her to ride her coattails. And he didn't have those things as social capital to share with them. And he kind of got left in the dust. And so that really is a commentary that could be a larger discussion, you know?
And I will say I need to back up a little bit. She did become a little bit more likable to me whenever part of her struggle was revealed. So she wasn't black enough for one community. She wasn't white enough for the other one. So her having to navigate that, that's where it's like, okay, now she has layers to her. And I find myself being able to connect with her more. Whereas before, it was like, girl, you just too stuck up, self-centered.
She liked yourself. Him. I thought that it was going to come out that she had a crush on him or something. And she was pushing him away. But then as I kept reading, it almost felt like she was afraid of what he was. Like he was her fear. Like she didn't, because she like how she said she wasn't black enough, she wasn't white enough, that she looked at him as that's how people view most black people. And she was afraid, like she was afraid of being viewed like that. I don't know, but that's kind of how I was feeling at the end. But definitely in the beginning, I thought she had a crush on him. And you know how kids do when they have a crush on somebody and they're just mean and rude, but I guess that's not what that was.
Now, somebody who did have a crush on somebody, Wes had a crush on Alyssa. Alyssa was my second favorite character outside of Kari. I really liked Alyssa.
Christ, I just knew you were going to come here and say that Mr. Baker. Is that his name?
The teacher?
Because always love the teacher.
I do like Mr. Baker. He was an ally and he really had high expectations for his students. So he's my third favorite. But I just thought that Alyssa was well-rounded and she was so positive. I think because of what Amy talked about with Kari. So Kari was number one. But Alyssa, just because she was smart, but she also was kind. She was personable. She was very helpful. I just thought she was a very likable character.
There's always that friend that holds the group together. She's the glue for sure.
Mm-hmm. And she was that link between Maya and Maya's new world and the old friend group, I think, a lot.
I mean, any of these characters, I think, could have their own, like, spinoff and book. Because there for a while, I was worrying that, like, maybe Maya was kind of a bad influence on Alyssa as far as, like, the turkey sandwiches at lunch and wouldn't eat anything else. Brent was interesting to me, too. What did y'all think about Brent?
I like the dynamic between him and Wes because they were typical boys. Like they had an argument, they got upset, then they said what it was and they're like, we good? Yeah, we good. And then they move on. I feel like I've seen boys like that in my classroom. You know, I don't know. It just, and I grew up with brothers and that's just how it is. Like you're mad for a moment and then they look and they're like, you good? Yeah, I'm good.
Did y'all agree with what Brent said, that everything didn't have to be about Wes? I thought that kind of stung, like, dang, he brought it out. Because being an only child, you're so used to things being centered around you, and I can relate to this, that sometimes it's not about you.
I love that, though, because I felt like Brent really was a good friend because he told the truth. You know, you've got mm-hmm. those friends that'll kind of say what you want to hear. He said what he needed to hear, and, you know, he was right. And that's really where he kind of had that heart change and stopped making everything about himself, and that's where you saw him develop. So, I mean, Brent, he was a rock star in that regard. I love that about him. He was confident in himself, and he didn't worry that you might hurt your feelings. He was going to say what you needed to hear.
Wes, though. Because, like, you know, I know that, like, I felt like Wes had a hard time with it because, you know, like, Brent was his friend. And I don't think he necessarily, like, I don't know. I think he just wanted Brent to be more supportive of the movement, even though his family maybe had accepted the offer, but, you know, was kind of wanting Brent to be more, I guess, helpful for the cause.
Yeah, I didn't like that part where Brent pulled back and wasn't involved in it and supportive. And I almost like felt like that was a little out of character. I mean, they're not my characters, I don't get to say, but like I didn't feel like that's who I wanted him to be. I thought like they were so tight, they got, you know, they had each other's backs. And then when it came down to even just being a part of it or being involved in it, that didn't mean like you're not moving or whatever. Like he was like, no, I'm out. And like really just kind of turned his back on them there for a little bit.
I could see that happening.
Go ahead.
I could see that happening because his dad was so vocal and, you know, all those meetings were very contentious. And so that's what we heard about. We didn't hear about all the individual conversations that Brent overheard. And then we discovered mm-hmm. that Brent and his family were not well off. And so therefore this gave him an opportunity to get some of the things that have a little bit more access. And so that made it where I understand what you're saying, where it's like, what's going on with Brent? But then when those things were kind of revealed, it's like, okay, I can see where this is coming from.
I did really admire him when he stood up and told Wes, like, it's not about you. And I do think, like, sometimes we need to hear that. Sometimes we just need to be put on pause and step back and take ourselves out of something. And I really felt like Emily said, like, he was a good friend to Wes, and that, you know, you have to be a true friend to be willing to say that.
And I think it's a heavy burden for a kid to carry the weight of, oh, my friends are able to buy these shoes or have this jacket or whatever, and I can't. And the only way I can is if I move away from everybody that I care about. You know, that's tough. And, you know, for a middle school boy, maybe he just didn't have the words to even process it. So he's just like, I'm just going to back off, you know, because he seemed like he always was cool about everything, had everything together. So maybe he thought, well, if I'm not ready to talk about it, I'm just not going to talk about it, you know?
I was thinking he didn't want to be viewed as a hypocrite, or like he wanted to take a stand with his family. Sure. You know, like, how can I be out here protesting with you and saying that, what, you know, be a part of the movement, but then on the other hand, my family has taken the deal because we see the benefit in that too. And maybe, like you said, Emily, he just didn't know how to verbalize, you know, how he was feeling about all of it. Because it is heavy.
Mm-hmm. A heavy topic. And I love the way that Chrystal was able to bring a resolution that was not a cookie cutter resolution where, okay, automatically, you know, the neighborhood is just going to be saved and kumbaya and everything's going to be back together. It's like, well, we have to go through this process of it becoming a historic district. There'll be guidelines, but people can still sell if that's what they choose to do, which is more realistic in terms of what happens. So I really just love the way that it came out in such a really authentic way.
But I do think we need a spinoff about Kari. Like, where does he go from here now? And I was so worried for him. As soon as he had said that they were going to move, I knew that wasn't going to be good for him. And like, I need to know that he's okay.
I was kind of torn, though, about him living with the Hendersons. Because
really?
I was torn because of the message that it sends. Like, I'm just a person who just thinks that you have to navigate your new environment and you have to figure it out. And I've had times where, you know, I've had to stay with relatives or things of that nature, as opposed to now you need to go live with a whole new family that's in a two-parent household because your mom can't. He's getting into trouble and it's not good, but I am a little torn about him being out of his household with his family and now living in this more traditional family with the Henderson. Even though I do know they love and support him, I'm just torn.
I was thrown a little bit on the timeline when that happened, and Wes had said, oh, like, you can come live with us. You can at least finish out the school year or something along those lines, you know, or when he was talking to his parents, like, can't he at least? So, like, in my mind, I'm like, oh, it must be, like, March. And then, like, the next chapter, it's like, and Halloween's my favorite time. I'm like, wait a second, you wanted him to stay from, like, October to May or June? And you just thought, like, oh, my parents will be fine. You didn't even have to ask them or check with them on that.
And was upset when they didn't go along with it initially. Yeah. I mean, he was mad.
I have two of the most surprising times in the book for me. That's one of them. Because it just in other books, the family would have definitely taken the boy in. Yeah. Like, that would have happened and that would have just solved that problem. But this was a problem that was reoccurring through the story. And I appreciated that because that was like a little bit of a twist for me, because I just knew for sure the parents were going to be upset with Wes for extending that invitation, but still take the boy in, but they didn't. So that was the first time I was like, ooh. And the second time, still around Kari, was when they were cleaning up after one of their events and he was taken by the police. I wasn't expecting that, which I feel like was perfect because you don't expect that. And in real life, it's going to happen, or it does happen. You know, I don't know. Kari, I agree with all of you. He needs his own book.
Mm-hmm. I still don't understand with the police situation, why that officer took him to a station that was not within that jurisdiction. Because if that officer worked at this other station in this other jurisdiction, then what was he doing in Kensington Oaks? Like, I just don't understand.
That's a real life question, Sans.
Yeah.
Real life
question. Put yourself places you don't belong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then too, like, the increased, like, police presence that happened after that, like, it made me wonder why that was happening. Like, was it come from, like, the corporation that was trying to buy the place, like, trying to run people off? that bothered me.
Well, that's kind of what I suspected, that they were, you know, perhaps even paying him to make extra patrol rounds or something like that. But just backtracking a little bit too, thinking about Kari and his sense of responsibility, you know, him moving in with Wes's family solved a problem, sort of, kind of, you know, it kind of seems like it's solving a problem because it gives him a safe place to be. But then he was the man of the house. He had, you know, that sense of responsibility for his little sister and for taking care of his mom. And I just feel like he had so much on his shoulders that even if he was there, it wouldn't have been satisfying as a resolution for him. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see that. I also like the way that she included the way that, I guess, Maya's neighborhood or the neighborhood over, how the police presence was there on bicycles and such, and how it was over in their neighborhood. I mean, these are real things, and it's just sprinkled in so that middle school students can understand it and be exposed to it, but not in a way that's you know, shoving it down people's throats.
Yeah. I did really like Mr. Baker. He was wonderful. And then Monica, I was really glad to find out that they were together. They're just like a perfect power couple.
I had suspected that when he first called her. I had wondered if there was a relationship there. So I was glad there was.
Another one.
Audiobook. I was going to say, I did the audiobook, and so Mr. Baker had like this news anchor kind of voice, and so that just gave me different imagery for him.
Well, and another character I was just going to speak about that we haven't talked about a lot, but that I really liked, was Mr. Hank. And those are those old guys in the neighborhood that everybody's got a Mr. Hank somewhere, you know, and I just loved that he was like a part of the family. And I like, you know, he wasn't a major character, but he was important, you know, and I would love to see little sprinklings of that kind of stuff more. I think we could definitely have a whole series about these characters because they just felt really real to me.
And another one we haven't talked about who I absolutely loved was Wes's mom. Just that she was instilling in him the sense of responsibility for community and the care for others. And she wasn't just saying it or doing it superficially. She was doing the work, and she was, you know, taking him into these experiences to bring him into that as well.
And I also like that she was a librarian. So when it came down to him needing to do this extensive amount of research and things, it wasn't something like, okay, now he's a super sleuth and can get in there and do all this research. It was, you know, he had been exposed to this because of his powerhouse mom. I thought she was a very great role model. Very, you know, she walks in the room, she owns it, she commands the space and is so well respected. So I really appreciated, you know, Maxine Henderson.
One of my favorite parts was when Wes was going to do the research. He's like, let me put my librarian training to work or something like that. Like, yes, boy.
Did you think that there might have been sort of a warning to parents too, the way we push things on our kids? Because you know how he was saying, you know, his birthday, I don't remember if it was the day or if it was coming up, but like he had been at some sort of event every weekend. Birthday. Yeah, every weekend. And it was almost in the beginning felt like he wasn't going to spend his birthday doing something he wanted to do, but he was going to be at another event. I think it was almost like a warning to, like, yeah, you want the good things for your kids and you want to give them exposure and put them in all the right places and, I don't know, build them up, but you have to give them time to just be kids too
and develop their own interest. Mm-hmm. Because you can share your thoughts and things and you certainly can influence, but you also want them to be able to have their own worldview. And this comes from somebody who doesn't have any children, but that's my philosophy.
But it's true. Like, you know, as a parent, we try to put all those good things in them. And we hope that later when they need to call upon the skill, they can, like his library skills. She put that in him when he needed it. He was able to pull from it, but we don't want them to drown in all the things that we want for them because they want things for themselves too.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Well, this is a really excellent book. So if you are looking for a great summer read, pick up Take Back the Block by Chrystal D. Giles. Giles. And when we return, we're going to speak with Chrystal D. Giles. We'll be right back with the author of Take Back the Block. We are back on the Tar Heel Teachers Book Club, and we're now being joined by Chrystal D. Giles, author of Take Back the Block. Chrystal, thank you so much for being here. Love this book.
Awesome. Thank you so much for having me.
Yes. Yeah, so, and you're in North Carolina in Charlotte. So we're really honored to chat with you. So your debut novel, Take Back the Block, has received multiple star reviews, was a Kirkus Review, School Library Journal, and NPR Best Book. Can you talk about your experience bringing this book to life? Was it really easy for you to convince the powers that be that there's an audience for a middle grade novel about gentrification, affordable housing, and displacement?
So the easy answer to that is I didn't have as hard a time as I thought. It took me some convincing of myself first. I had not read a middle grade novel with these themes. And so when I first thought about it, I thought, one, can I make it interesting enough that young people will want to read it? And then two, how do I handle cultural, historical pieces that I felt like needed to be there? So after I convinced myself I could do it, I knew I had to be as authentic as possible. And I tried to put as much information as I could in the book. And so I started there and I said, if I'm true to the topic and if I give as many perspectives as I can, I'll be fine, even if no one likes it. So that's where I started. Interestingly enough, when I started to pitch the book, I got interest for it. And I think for sure I stand on the shoulders of kind of this movement where people are actually interested in diverse stories and particularly things that are authentic and feel real. And so I didn't get a lot of pushback there. During the editing process, we did kind of refine some of the information so it wouldn't come off as teachy, but I honestly can say I haven't gotten much pushback on the publishing side. I've seen some things on the other side with parents and things like that. But on the publishing side, I didn't get much pushback.
Well, you really did a great job with it. It was a great opportunity for young people to learn about these really important topics, but in a very authentic, relatable way, because the characters that you brought to life were just fantastic. So I just loved the way that you put all this stuff in this powerful book. What questions do we have for Chrystal?
Well, speaking of the characters, we've been just gushing over all of these people. We want them all to have their own books, first of all. So I'm just curious, you know, did you pull any of these people from your personal life, or are there people that you're like, oh yeah, this one's Kari or this one's Wes, you know, because they really do feel very authentic. We loved them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So that's a huge compliment because I wanted the characters to feel real. They are not real people, but little components. So I knew I needed Wes to be charming and stylish, and I knew I wanted him to be interesting enough that the young readers would like him. I wanted him to be likable. And so he's stylish because as a kid, I love sneakers. I still love sneakers. You'll catch me in Air Max quite often. So I gave him that component. The other characters remind me some of my friends, some of my husband, just little bits and pieces. So probably if you know me and if you're in my life, you can find bits and pieces of yourself throughout the story. I also wanted to give Wes a crew. In this neighborhood, I feel like there are lots of young people and I wanted him to have a group of people because throughout the story, you'll notice some of the people fall away and sometimes they don't appear and then they're back. And so I always wanted him to have at least one person kind of on by his side.
Do you have, on that note, do you have a lot of experience with like middle schoolers? Because their voice and their relationships with each other was just so authentic. And we were talking about that earlier. So I'm curious like how you made them so real.
I do not. I have a son who is right around 7 years old, so he's not quite this age. What I did, I read a lot. So voice is one of those things that's really hard to teach. It's one of those things that you have to just kind of absorb and get just right. I started out with this book in third person and the voice wasn't quite there. It felt a bit distant. And I did a total rewrite to first person. And that's when I really found Wes's voice. He kind of just jumped off the page and it helped me realize that I didn't have to protect him from the source material. I could just put him right in it. So my goal with making the characters feel real was just to put him right in the middle of the story. And that's honestly kind of my main motivation for writing. I want to put real kids on the page and I want them to feel like, oh, that's me, or that's the kid up the street, or that's my neighbor. So that's probably one of the things I work the hardest at.
I know Wes, I know Maya, I know all those people.
I was visiting a school virtually in Atlanta, and before the session started, it was like teachers and students. And a couple of the kids was like, no, I'm Wes. No, you're Wes. And like, that was it. Like, that's just enough. I was like, okay, we can go home now, because, you know, I really want kids to feel like that's me when they read the story.
You've kind of tipped into my question a little bit. I read that you are an avid reader and have been for most of your life. And I'm interested to know, what are some of your favorite stories and how have any of those stories impacted the way that you write?
So probably everyone's a huge fan of Jason Reynolds. I think when I started reading young books again, he let me know that I could write authentically. I remember books from when I was a child. I read tons of like Babysitter's Club, Boxcar Children, those kind of things. And they were interesting. And, you know, I read them, but I didn't quite see myself in those books. After my son was born, I started reading more children's books again. And I got really interested in looking for books that reflected kind of my family. And I stumbled upon Jason Reynolds and I was like, oh my goodness, this is like, these are real kids. So for sure, he's a motivation. I love Rita Williams Garcia, of course, her Gaither Sisters series, but I love, love, love her book, Clayton Bird Goes Underground. That one, I think for setting and voice, is another one that completely let me know that even I could write a young Black boy, even though I'm not a young Black boy. And it helped me really, have the confidence to work on voice enough to make it feel authentic.
That's cool. And the last thing I just wanted to ask, I love the cover art and I'm curious to know, the skyline is way in the back, but is that Charlotte? That's what I thought.
So the story about that is the cover art is by Richie Pope. Mm-hmm. He I'm not sure where he's from, but everyone in publishing is like in the New York area. And they had originally drawn the houses as like high rises. And I'm like, no. That's not the city I'm writing about. So they revised, they gave me smaller houses. And it didn't quite feel like my city yet. So they decided to make it a little bit of a city. So far in the background, they got the Charlotte skyline. And I was like, okay, that's it. That's Charlotte. So took some doing.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So like Emily kind of said, we were all like, we need more. But even if there wasn't more, which we hope there are more, what other issues could you see Wes tackling, since he's kind of got his hand in advocacy now and he's done great with that? What other issues would you like to see Wes take on?
Oh, that's a great question. So there is not a planned sequel for this book. I get this question a lot. So maybe one day, I don't know. I think one of the issues that come right out of gentrification and changing neighborhoods is the disparities in schools. And so I really wanted to dive deeper into what happens when neighborhoods are like transformed or they transition. And for sure in Charlotte, we've got a couple neighborhoods where the schools absolutely swap and they go from being like 90% Black or in 10% white. And then as the transition happens and those neighborhoods transform, the school and the demographics of the school switch. And so suddenly all of the students that were in that area, they get pushed somewhere else, and then the demographic of that school changes. And so I would love to explore that. And I think possibly it could happen in an environment where Kensington Oaks is, and what happens kind of thereafter, what happens to the school environment and things like that. So if I had to do another book in that world, I think perhaps I could explore that a little bit.
That's a good idea. And then I had one more question. So me and Arisha both did the audio version and loved the audio version. How does that process go with like picking a narrator for your book? Do you get any say in that?
Oh, the narrator did such a great job. His name is Genesis Oliver. So I did get to listen to, I think they sent me over 4 samples, and 2 of them were amazing. And then 1 sounded like Wes did in my head. And I was like, oh, that's him, that's him. So luckily he was available and he was excited to read. And then the process is very fast. You know, they're professional. So, you know, he got it done really, really quickly. And he's actually, a lot of times in publishing, we don't get to actually talk to kind of our partners in terms of artists or voice actors, but he's been great. And we kind of chat with each other on social media. And so I'm hoping maybe he'll get to do my next book if he's available and if he's interested.
Chrystal, what can you tell us? I know you can you give us a little bit about Not an Easy Win? It's going to be published next February, and we're really excited about that. What can you share with us?
I'm so excited about it. We are going to reveal the cover next week. It's another middle grade contemporary. It's about a boy who lives kind of in rural North Carolina. So we go from kind of city center to like a rural town. And it's a made up town, but it's kind of modeled after a town where lots of my family grew up. The town, I call it Laurenville. It's kind of named after a town called Laurenburg, where lots of
I know Laurenburg.
Awesome. So lots of my family are from that area. I visited a lot as a kid. So I tweaked the name just a bit just because. But it's about a boy, he's 12, and he has to move from Charlotte to this town, and he doesn't like it very much because it's kind of boring. He's also having some issues in school and kind of feeling left out and alone. And he stumbles into a rec center and they are playing competitive chess there. And so to fit in, he decides that he will learn how to play chess. And so it's a story really about friendship and forgiveness. He goes through a lot of kind of family challenges in this rural town away from what he considers to be his home. And he finds all of these new friends and he learns how to win because he's had a lot of losses. So the title is about learning how to win. And then also he learns how to tell his own story. So I'm really excited about it. Like you said, it's out in February of next year.
Really excited about that. Any other pressing questions for Chrystal? Really excited to read that book and love Take Back the Blog. Well, Chrystal, we want to thank you so much for joining us. And the book was quite delightful, and you already have some great ideas for the sequel. So go ahead and get started on it because we can't wait to read it.
Thank you so much.
We really appreciate it. Again, Chrystal's next middle grade novel, Not an Easy Win, will be published in February 2023. To stay up to date with her work, please visit her website, crystaldgiles.com, and follow her on Twitter at creativelychris. And an Instagram at Chrystal D. Giles. When we return, we'll discuss instructional strategies if you want to read Take Back the Block. And why wouldn't you want to read it? It is so good. We'll be right back. We are back on the Tar Heel Teachers Book Club, and now we're going to discuss some instructional strategies if you want to teach Take Back the Block by Chrystal D. Giles. Ideas that we would like to share with our colleagues across the state.
Well, it is summer break, so I didn't put a whole lot of thought into teaching strategies, I'll be honest.
People are still planning.
We're planning. But because he does call on his librarian skills when he has to do research, of course, you got great areas of research. And I would take Mr. Baker's idea of like his social justice projects and finding an area to research while you're teaching research skills and reliable sources and all of those great things, but putting it together in a real world, something that affects me kind of project.
Well, and I would love to see someone dig deeper into gentrification, because kids at that age may understand it in real life, like they may have experienced it and not even know that it's called that. And, you know, for those kids in the story, some of them have very different perspectives about how it impacted them and whether they agreed with it or not. You know, were they going to take the money or not take the money? So perhaps, you know, if a kid had a strong opinion one way or the other, have them debate the opposite opinion, the one that they don't feel strongly about. So they have to research that side a little bit more and kind of understand both sides of the situation a little bit better.
In addition to that, Emily, really outlining the difference between gentrification and revitalization and being able to distinguish that, because sometimes people don't know, but the more that we can dig into it, and there will be different opinions, which is really important, and that's life.
Thinking about digital graphic art and design, but also tied in with social justice, finding causes that they care about and creating posters. I just think about the world we're living in now, graphic design, learning how to create these images for online postings. So I was thinking about that, but then even doing a print version where they could print it out and create jigsaw puzzles, since Wes was so into puzzles, having these social justice posters that were also puzzles, I thought would have been cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he loved the puzzles. I love that.
I kind of thought the same thing about like graphic, but like making like a character board, I guess, like letting students like make a collage of all the things that they think would be important to that specific character, you know, like with Wes, obviously, like you'd have his Tar Heel jersey and other symbolic things for the character. But I love the pulling it apart for a jigsaw puzzle. But I do think there's a lot of digital things that could go into this research wise. Y'all know me, I'm always like looking at like standards that it could tie into. And it really hit, I love the figurative language. The figurative language was just touched in there and sprinkled throughout, and I loved it.
Well, and the figurative language hit me as well. And then since our dear friend Kelly is not here this week, she's traveling, I went to music and I thought, well, you know, take that poem kind of element, the figurative language, make it a rap. I was thinking about the character Jazz and how he was, you know, always drumming on something.
Yes.
And have a beat and have them do performance art of those poems or whatever that they came up with. And I just thought, you know, those creative kids would take that and run with it.
I feel like you could also do some, go ahead, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, like, I didn't know if maybe you could also have students do research as far as, like, what things on the historical deeds are in your town, like, because I know that's something that, like, I may be walking through town, I may see, like, one of those plaques, but I really don't know anything about it, so allowing students to research something that way.
A book, it's been out for a long time. It's Making Thinking Visible. One of the strategies in there is called Circle of Perspectives. And I was thinking about how many different characters there were who had so many varying backgrounds. When you're doing like your literature circles or your seminars, book discussions, having the students take on those characters, and they can only communicate during that class period from that person, whichever character they took on, from that person's perspective. So they're going to speak as Wes, they're going to speak I'm trying to think of another one, as Jazz or Kari or Alyssa. I think that would be very interesting.
It's funny because I had a similar thought when Crystal was talking about how she changed the perspective of the whole book and did a complete rewrite. It made me think, you know, if a kid did a journal entry as one of those characters in that perspective, just to see how the story changes, you know, like, okay, chapter 3, you're going to kind of write it from a different kid's perspective. How does that change the story? I could see there being some interesting perspectives that we don't catch because we only hear Wes's thoughts, you know?
I think there are a lot of like, what would you do moments throughout this book. Like when Kari showed up to get clothes, but all his friends were there. Like, pause. Like, what would you do to help Kari? Like, would you just call him out in front of his friends? And like, even at the very beginning, when you're at the protest and you wanted to hide, like, what would you do? Would you hide behind a porta potty, or would you go out and face the music? And when you get to, you know, finding a fun way, when they were talking about the, like, the block party and brainstorming, like, pause before that. And like, what would you do to bring awareness? And I just think sprinkled throughout the book, there's so many opportunities for kids to talk about and think about what they would have done in those situations.
I love that so much, Sans. Like, I, in my brain, can hear, like, you know, those guys who do like the movie, the voiceovers for the movie advertisement, like, what would you do? You're at the park and it's not, you know, whatever. And then you have the, like, some sort of image on the, you know, on your slide, you press pause, you have your, what do you do moment, have the kids interact. I think I love that. Like, I can see that in my head.
Yeah, that's a good idea. And what would you do if Miss Hardy gave you your paper last because you had a lower grade?
Oh, that my was, God. That was such a terrible practice.
Such a terrible practice. I think something like that, because some things that Mr. Baker did and some things that Miss Hardy did, that could be some things that could be just excerpts that could be shared in a new teacher orientation to give teachers some perspectives of some things to do and what not to do, because I could not believe she did that, and she needs to be written up and or terminated. At least written up. That would be bad.
Got some better practices sent to some PDs.
Oh my gosh.
That would scar you for something like that. Also, I think it would be important, since there was so much community service and was a community oriented, having students to do some type of service learning on project. So really being able to determine what that is and having some ideas, because there was a lot going on, and we all can serve. We all can be leaders because we all can serve. So really helping to facilitate that could be really exciting. And then also facilitating guest speakers. I mean, these are some really heavy topics, and we have people in our communities who are addressing these types of things or involved in these types of things, whether it's the mayor or city council members or developers, and really giving them an opportunity to speak to the children about their work and what it entails to really make it concrete. So it's not just happening tape at the block. This is happening in your community in some type of way. It might not be, you know, neighborhoods being torn down and condos being put up, but some of this stuff is happening because all of our communities are being developed in some ways. And so how do we really make sure our kids can have access to these professionals who are, you know, navigating these spaces?
There has to be like some severe intentionality with teaching vocabulary. And I would think you would have to do some sort of visual vocabulary, because reading and just writing the definition of what activism is not enough. Like, you have to see that thing in motion, or gentrification or social justice or privilege or any of these things. You're going to have to do some serious groundwork with vocabulary.
You know, when you were talking earlier about the visuals and making posters, I could see kids making posters for those in Canva or something like that. Mm-hmm. And that would be a really powerful visual, you know, finding those iconic images that are going to represent that, and then expressing, this is why I chose this, you know, that's how they really remember those words and what they mean.
Right. And there are also some great documentaries about gentrification as well, to be able to show kids some excerpts so they can really see the way that it has impacted communities across our nation. And Arisha was talking earlier about parents, activists giving their children space to be able to develop on their own. There is an article about the effects that activism has had on some famous children of activists, because, you know, they were so busy giving themselves to the movement that it may have impacted their parenting. So that also could be something interesting to explore, because so many sacrifices are made. I mean, Wes had to make the sacrifice and go on his birthday, but it's also sacrifices that the parents make, things that they miss with their kids because they're so involved in their community and trying to make change.
So this is so not the best example, right? But I'm pretty sure most of you have seen, is it Mother or Mommy Dearest? What is the name of that movie?
Mommy Dearest.
Is it Mommy Dearest? But like, how I just had this one scene in my head where she has this huge birthday party for her daughter, and she gets all these gifts, and then everybody goes home, and then she opens up all the gifts, and she's so excited, and then she says, pick one, because we're donating the rest. Like, we don't want to do that to our kids. We don't, like, we want to teach them to give and to be there for other people, but we don't want to harm them in that process, you know? Like, the things that we're doing for them are supposed to build their confidence. They can be there for other people, but not that way, not as severe as Mommy Dearest.
Yeah, their expectations can be there. I mean, if that's going to be the expectation that you're going to get some items, but we're going to donate that, and you've already prepped your child for that, they're not anticipating that they're going to have a chance to open up all these presents. They already know that it's going to be a process. So, yeah, I think that's a good point.
Well, I know a lot of people, like around holidays where there's gift givings or birthdays, they always go through like some of the things that they have that are still in, like, you know, good or excellent condition that they don't use much of it. And prior to receiving gifts, they donate things first to make room for new things in their life. And I think that's a better way to go about doing something like that. But, you know, there are ways that you can introduce those things that aren't as harmful.
Yeah.
Right. So much that you can do with Take Back the Block, and it was a really enjoyable read. So again, if you're looking for a read, why don't you pick up our June 2022 Tar Heel Teachers Book Club selection? You will not regret it. We look forward to seeing you next time on the Tar Heel Teachers Book Club.